Mr. President, yesterday I mentioned how our colleagues across the aisle, and of course some groups outside of Capitol Hill, have predictably started attacking tax reform, and actually a plan that doesn't even yet exist in legislative language. With the fall season now upon us, they've decided to shoot arrows at a straw man. You'd think, given their effusive support for tax reform in the past, our Democratic friends would at least wait to review the legislation before they pounce on it. And I would hope that they would work with us to come up with a bipartisan plan. But I guess I'm not entirely surprised. That's never stopped them from pillaring smart policy before when it served a political end. Yes, they're already piling on and spreading misinformation and assuming the worst, because that's the easy and politically expedient thing to do. The problem is that many of the criticisms of our framework have been misleading and counterproductive. Worse, some members seem more content to misconstrue a plan than they do to understanding it and giving it a fair hearing. So allow me to clarify the record for just a moment. What's most striking is that the new framework unveiled by the so-called Big Six shares many of the core features of previous plans that were widely embraced by Democrats. And not only that, many of the folks that are now critical of the new plan came out in support of these provisions as recently as this year. So our colleague, the senior senator from Oregon, is typical in this regard. In response to our framework, he said, "This is a far-right Republican scheme to endow future generations of the mega wealthy and leave what amounts to crumbs for the middle class behind." Kind of a breathtaking allegation. Those are indeed strong statements, but the American people are smart. The American people realize that the plan that our colleague from Oregon is criticizing is similar to the one he sponsored and promoted in 2011. So let's get the facts straight. So the senator from Oregon had previously sponsored a plan in 2011 with our former colleague, Senator Coates of Indiana, called the Wyden-Coates Plan. And here on the left, of course, is the Big Six framework that he described. Let me read that again. He said, "This is a far-right Republican scheme to endow future generations of the mega wealthy and leave what amounts to crumbs for the middle class behind." Well, here's the framework he was criticizing by the language I just provided, and here is his plan in 2011. Each of these plans, the Wyden-Coates plan from 2011, the one we're considering now, is based on three individual tax rates. Both the plan the senator from Oregon once supported and the one we are now discussing, the framework, would collapse seven tax brackets in the current system down to three, vastly simplifying the tax code and the burden of complying with that tax code by ordinary Americans. Each plan also eliminates the alternative minimum tax on this line. It vastly increases the standard deduction. The Wyden-Coates plan would have tripled it. The Big Six framework that he criticized doubles the standard deduction, making it so that a married couple who earned $24,000 or less would be essentially in a zero tax bracket. So my question is, what has changed, other than the political party of the president in office? These changes to our tax code used to be non-controversial, certainly not partisan. So the Big Six plan isn't just similar to the Wyden one, though. It also shares key features with the so-called Simpson-Bowles plan from 2010 that not long ago was embraced by a number of Democrats, including the current minority whip, the senator from Indiana. So here's a comparison of the so-called Big Six framework and the Simpson-Bowles plan. As you can see, there's a lot of similarities here. Seven brackets collapsed into three, eliminating the alternative minimum tax, eliminating a number of itemized deductions, or so-called base broadeners. It enhances the child tax credit, and it lowers the corporate rate. These proposals were once a no-brainer for Republicans and Democrats alike. So why the change in tune? Our Democratic colleagues used to think these reforms were long overdue, and they were right then, and they're wrong now. None other than the Senate Minority Leader, our colleague from New York, has said that to preserve our international competitiveness, it is imperative that we seek to reduce the corporate tax rate from 35%. That was the senator from New York in 2012. He said, this will boost growth and encourage more companies to reinvest in the United States. He was absolutely correct in 2012. And he's entirely wrong now to change his view and suggest that this is somehow a wrong way to approach getting the economy growing again and encouraging businesses that earn money overseas to bring that money back home and invest it in businesses and jobs and pay for American workers here at home. We do need to change incentives, and we do need to spur growth. That's why the new framework we're considering will create a new tax structure for small businesses, allowing them to better compete. Once upon a time, none of this was particularly partisan, and many of our colleagues across the aisle got the picture. Our colleagues from Ohio, Minnesota, and Missouri have all said in recent years that we should lower the corporate tax rate, not because we love corporations, but because we recognize that that provides incentives for them to stay here and invest in jobs and businesses in America rather than overseas. But it also makes it more likely that hardworking Americans will be able to find a job, and that the jobs they hold will actually pay better wages. And thanks to our reduction in individual tax rates, they'll actually be able to have more take-home pay. And as some have pointed out, this literally would raise their standard of living, make it possible for them to provide for their children's education, maybe buy a reliable car so they can go back and forth to their job every day, maybe buy a home, or perhaps save for their retirement. Well, there's nothing partisan about wanting an updated and more competitive tax code that will incentivize businesses to keep jobs on American soil. That's what the so-called reduction in the corporate rate will do. Right now, we have the highest corporate rate in the world. So many businesses have simply picked up their roots here in America, and they've moved overseas to companies, countries that have lower tax rates, because they simply can't rationalize to their shareholders, for whom they have a fiduciary duty, paying higher taxes and remaining in the United States. So they take it overseas. And even for those who stay behind, because of our extraordinarily high tax rate and the fact they literally would have to pay double taxes for income earned abroad and bring it back to the United States, pay the tax rate in the country where the money is earned, and bring it back to the United States, they'd have to pay twice. So 35% on top of whatever they have to pay in the country it's earned. So is it any wonder, for example, that IBM, I read today, or excuse me, this last weekend, actually has more jobs in India than it does in the United States. Let me say that again. IBM, the global computer company, has more jobs in India today than it does in the United States. Now, I have no doubt that that has to do with certain incentives that the country will pay to companies to invest and to build their business in their country. And no doubt it has to do with the access to skilled labor. That certainly has to be a part of it. But there can be no doubt that our tax code is simply encouraging companies like IBM to shift more and more of their work overseas. And even if they wanted to bring the money that they earned overseas back to the United States, they'd have to pay twice. And so what do? They simply invest in their workforce. They simply invest in their business in another country, much to our detriment. So if something's broken, which our tax code is, it needs to be fixed, not avoided. Our Democratic colleagues need to once again acknowledge this, so as so many of them did when it came to our outdated tax code, as I pointed out. There is no reason why tax reform can't be bipartisan. And if our colleagues just return to some of their statements, which I've highlighted here, if they've returned to those policies in a bipartisan fashion and worked with us, we could change our tax code for the better so that we could make it simpler. We could make sure that individuals had lower tax rates so they could have more take-home pay from the wages they earn, and in the process, improve their standard of living for themselves and their families. And then finally, we could become more competitive in a global economy where the highest tax rate in the world does not serve American interests well. It doesn't serve American businesses' interests well, and it doesn't serve American workers' or taxpayers' interests either. So we can do this, Mr. President. All it takes is political will. All it takes is approaching this in a fashion that benefits all Americans on a nonpartisan basis. And I hope our colleagues will listen.